I'd like to first give Jesus honor this morning. I'd like to honor Pastor Reeves. I'd like to honor my fellow ministers in the gospel. And those of you who are in social media, we say good morning to you as well. And for the sake of time, I'm going to ask if you would turn with me to a very familiar passage of Scripture from 2 Chronicles, the 7th chapter of 2 Chronicles. And when you have found it, I'm going to ask if you would stand in reverence to the reading of God's Word. 2 Chronicles chapter 7, and we're going to read verses 12 through 16 together. And the Lord appeared to Solomon by night, and said unto him, I have heard thy prayer, and have chosen this place to myself for a house of sacrifice. If I shut up heaven, that there be no rain, or if I command the locusts to devour the land, or if I send pestilence among my people, if my people, which are called by my name, shall humble themselves and pray, and seek my face, and turn from their wicked ways, then I will hear from heaven, I will forgive their sins, and heal their land. Now my eyes shall be opened, and my ears attent unto the prayer that is made in this place, for now I have chosen and sanctify this house, that my name may be there forever, and my eyes and my heart shall be there perpetually. Father God, we just come to you once again in the blessed name of Jesus. Father God, we just ask in the name of Jesus, let your word, this is your word, let it go forth, Father God, with power and with might. Father God, we just ask in the name of Jesus that your word would penetrate the walls of this building and go into social media and save souls out there as well as in here. And Father God, I'll be careful to give your name the glory, the honor, and the praise this day. Save, deliver, heal, set free, and make whole. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
You may be seated. I'd like to use for my subject this morning, does your temple belong to the Lord? Does your temple belong to the Lord? This book, Chronicles, or the affairs, or the annals of days, as it is called, gives us a chronological history and some insight into the political, economic, and national affairs of Israel during the reigns of both David and Solomon. As you read this text, the writer underscores the importance of obedience to God and to his laws. And the writer never tires of demonstrating how sin always brings judgment from God, whereas repentance, obedience, and trust will yield power, victory, and prosperity in the lives of God's people. Chronicles teaches us that obedience to God, that obedience to God's word is still relevant for us even in 2018.
Amen.
That's why God told Israel through the prophet Malachi, he said, I am the Lord and I change not. God church is holy. He always was holy. He always will be holy.
Yes.
God's standards never change. Here in our text this morning, we find King Solomon dedicating the house of God to the Lord himself. Now, before Solomon built this house, God's earthly house was simply a tent. And David, who was Solomon's father, wanted to build a grand house for the Lord. But God told David, no, you are a warrior, and you have shed too much blood. But God said, your son Solomon shall build me a house.
Yes.
I may not need it because I have a big mouth anyway. He said, your son Solomon shall build me a house. And if you go back to Samuel chapter 7 and verse 17, you will find God talking to his father David. And God told David, Solomon, your son shall be my son.
Amen.
And I will establish your kingdom, and your throne shall last forever. And what we see in those passages of scripture is that God does things on his own timetable. God does things his own way. That's why God said, my ways are not your ways, and my thoughts are not your thoughts. God may be different, but one thing we can be sure of is that God always keeps his promise.
Yes.
So years later, after David died, we find Solomon presenting the temple to the Lord. Now the temple in this day and age was important because the temple represented heaven on earth.
Yes.
It was supposed to reflect the holy and righteous atmosphere of heaven down here on planet earth.
Yes.
It was the place where God's spirit would reside with his people. It was the place where God's people could come and bow down and worship him and praise him. It was a reminder to God's people that God was here with them. He was not in some distant galaxy. He was not in some distant solar system, but God was there with them to guide them, to protect them, and to comfort them.
Amen.
And the Bible tells us that Solomon did something. The Bible says that Solomon offered sacrifices unto the Lord. Now, a true sacrifice, church, is always going to cost you something. A true sacrifice is something of great value that you give to God with the right heart, unselfishly. You are believing and trusting God that when you give this sacrifice, God is not going to leave you hanging.
Amen.
You will still be able to pay your bills. You will still be able to take care of your responsibilities.
Yes.
But when you give this sacrifice, you are basically saying, God, I love you. God, I trust you. And you're not just saying it, but you show it. And like I always say up here, love is an action word.
Yes.
God doesn't want us to just keep telling him he loves us, or we love him. He wants us to show him. He really wants us to show him. You know, God always promised that when we are faithful to him, that he will always, always, always keep his promise. But whenever we sin, we break that promise with God. That contract is broken until we repent and come back to God through Jesus Christ. That's why repentance is so important. Let me get back to my text. The Bible says that Solomon offered many sacrifices unto God. And the scripture says that the glory of the Lord filled the temple and consumed all of those sacrifices that had been offered unto him. And what that tells us is that whenever we offer God sacrifices and we do it with the right heart, not only will God accept them, but God will always stand with the presenter. Now the Bible says that Solomon offered 22,000 oxen unto God and 120,000 sheep unto the Lord. This was food that they could have used to feed the kingdom. But they weren't worried about food. They weren't worried about their stomachs. They were invoking God's divine favor for them. They were invoking God's divine protection for them. Even in the midst of a region of warring nations, they still trusted God. You know, during Solomon's time, Jesus had not been born yet. So the Spirit of God dwelled with his people. Not in them, but with them. But we have it better today, because Jesus came, died, and rose again. He sent what the Bible calls the Comforter. So whenever we come to God through Jesus Christ, the Bible says that we have been sealed with the Holy Ghost. The Holy Ghost is living inside of us. And that makes us even more powerful than those folks were back then. You know, if you receive the Spirit of promise, God has already done the hard part. So I'm going to ask you this morning, have you presented your temple unto God? Have you dedicated your body unto the Lord? Are God's desires your desires? Are God's ways your ways? Are God's thoughts your thoughts? I just want you to meditate on that for just a moment. You know, we say the scripture so much, I believe we quote it here at Harvest more than any other church. And it comes from Romans 12 and 2. And Paul says, I beseech you, brethren, by the mercies of God. Mercy is an act that is performed to alleviate some sort of suffering. And the mercies of God are acts that are given to every believer. If you are a child of God, you have rights to what God calls the mercies of God. The forgiveness of sins are one of the mercies of God. Being justified by faith is one of the mercies of God. Being baptized into Jesus is one of the mercies of God. Living free from condemnation are one of the mercies of God. And these mercies are given to every believer, no matter how old or young you are, no matter what your social status is. If you are a child of God, you have the mercies of God. And you should be excited about that. You should be excited that you have the mercies of God. It's those mercies that are ensured that you get to heaven.
Amen.
Instead of being completely separated from him when you leave this earth. So Paul says to present your bodies as a living sacrifice, your temple as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service. Have you presented your eyes unto God lately? Have you presented your mind unto God lately? Have you presented your tongue unto God lately? Have you presented your total being unto God lately? And if you haven't, why haven't you? And that's something I want you to meditate on this morning. We have so many people, even saints, that are doing so many things that are not pleasing to God. And you can't even tell who's saved and who's not. You know, there was a guy on my job, and the other day he got upset with one of the supervisors, and the language and stuff was flying everywhere. And they took him out of the building. He's a child of God. At least that's what he says. He needs to dedicate his temple unto God.
Good night.
And it's not just him. All of us struggle with that sometimes. We need to dedicate our temples unto God. And then Paul says to be not conformed to this world. Because this world is going to pass away. We are just pilgrims and strangers passing through. But ultimately, our destination is in heaven. This is not our home. New Jersey is not our home. Our home is in heaven. So he says to be not conformed to this world, but he says to be transformed by the renewing of your mind. If my mind has been renewed, then I can develop what the Bible calls the mind of Christ. If I have the mind of Christ, then I understand what God's plan is for the world. I understand that it is God's plan for men and women to come to the saving knowledge of Jesus Christ. Yeah. I understand that when men and women reject Jesus, that they're going to spend eternity completely separated from him. If I had the mind of Christ, then I should be burdened for the lost souls.
Amen.
Have you dedicated your temples to the Lord? Your body belongs to the Lord. Your body is your temple. And the Holy Spirit is living in your temple. And whenever we sin, what we are doing is we are grieving the Holy Spirit. And when we grieve the Holy Spirit and we don't get right with God, we can bring a righteous judgment upon our sins. That judgment can come in the form of AIDS. That judgment can come in the form of STD. It can come in the form of sterility. It can come in the form of cancer. It can come in the form of barrenness. It can come in the form of loneliness. Or God might say, come on up here.
Amen.
You're being a disgrace to my kingdom.
Yeah.
Lord, I'm only 30 years old. Come on up.
Yeah.
It's time for you to come home. You want to get in. You might get a little stolen, but you want to get in. But you can't stay down here and disgrace the evidence of Calvary. God doesn't play. That's why the Bible says the wages of sin is death. And it's not just a physical death, there's also a spiritual death. Whenever we sin and we stay in that sin, that communion, that fellowship that we have with God is broken until we come back and repent. And that bridge is then repaired. That's why it's so important to dedicate your temple to God. In verse 12, the Bible says, and the Lord appeared to Solomon. Whenever the Lord appears to someone, that person is special. He says, the Lord appeared to Solomon by night and said unto him, I have heard thy prayer and have chosen this place, this temple, this house that you built for me for a house of sacrifice. God appeared. And what that means is that God was pleased. So he chose to reside in the temple that God's people have built for him.
Amen.
And what it means is that God will use you. When we sacrifice unto God and we give it with a cheerful heart, God will use us. And he will use us in a mighty way. But sometimes I think what we miss we start looking at our situation. We start looking at what's going on around us. On my job, they're talking about a strike. And every day, people ask, are you going to strike? I ain't worried about no strike.
Amen.
I'm not worried about no strike. My source comes from God.
Amen.
I'm not worried about no strike. But there's a lot of people who are. And I think sometimes we take our eyes off of God and we forget who God is and we forget where God has brought us from and we start to waver like Peter on the water when he took his eyes off of Jesus. We need to keep our eyes on God.
Yes.
And we need to keep our eyes on God and not on the situation. I even find myself worried about wanting to make some more money, wanting some more hours, and some personal goal, and I start to waver, but sometimes I gotta get back and keep my eyes on God.
Yes.
God has a future for all of us.
Yes.
He has a future for me, and he has a future for you, but we gotta give our temples to the Lord.
Yes.
And when I say give your temple to the Lord, this is not a one-time deal. We need to give that temple to the Lord every day. Sometimes we need to do it several times a day. But we need to do it at least once a day. In verse 13, God says something to Solomon. He says, if I shut up heaven that there be no rain, or if I command locusts to devour the land, or if I send pestilence among my people, what God was letting Solomon know is that sometimes God was going to allow tests to come. When you get saved, it's not always going to be easy. Sometimes people think that when they come to Christ, they're not going to have no more problems. But when you come to Christ, that's really when your problems start to manifest themselves, especially if you're really trying to live for God. If the devil isn't bothering you, if the devil isn't attacking you, it's probably because you're not bothering him. And if you're not bothering the devil, then you're not doing your job. You need to reevaluate yourself. In verse 13, God was letting them know that life was not always going to be easy. Jesus said, in this life, ye shall have tribulations. Ye shall have trials. And the reason why we have trials is because we live in a sinful world. We're just like those poor fish living in the Passaic River. They're living, they're swimming around, but they're swimming around in contamination. And we're living in contamination right now. And we're going to stay that way until the Lord brings us home. Amen.
Amen.
That's why James said, I think he said, count it all joy when you fall into diverse temptations. You don't count it joy for the temptation, but you count it all joy because God is going to bring you through. There's a reward for you at the end if you get through it. But if you don't get through it, you have to take the test over and over and over again.
Yeah.
I know people failed the first grade 2 and 3 times when I was a kid. I couldn't imagine. And that's what it's like when we don't pass the test the first time. God promises to bring us out if we remain steadfast. And I'm glad that God allows tribulations to come into my life. I'm not always glad at the moment. But when I look back and reflect, I'm glad that he's allowed those tribulations to come into my life, because then I wouldn't know how powerful God really was unless if everything went perfect all the time.
Yeah.
We need to learn how to remain steadfast. And then he says in verse 14, he says, if my people, he didn't say the heathens around them, he said, if my people, peoples who are worshipers of Jehovah, he said, if my people, which are called by my name, shall humble themselves and pray and seek my face. You know, they've been talking about this border stuff nonstop on the news. And there was a little girl that was speaking pretty good English. And she was asking someone to call her aunt here in America to come get her. And she just kept asking, and kept asking, and kept asking. You can hear the tape, and they're just kind of ignoring her. And on one hand, I believe we need to do something about the border. But on the other hand, we need to be a compassionate people.
Yes.
And I don't know what the solution is, but God knows what the solution is. And it is so imperative that we as the people of God fall down on our faces and pray for what's going on down along that border. We need to pray for those people. We need to pray for this administration that God would even give them wisdom.
Amen.
God put Trump in that office. And so I say that God knows what he's doing. I question the president sometimes, but I know that God knows what he's doing.
Yeah.
But we need to get down on our knees, church, and we need to pray. And he says that my people will humble themselves and pray and seek my face. That is to seek God's will for our lives. He says something here, and turn from their wicked ways. It means that we can't serve God and mammon at the same time. We have to make a choice. Are we going to serve God all the way, or are we going to not serve him? That's
Amen.
What the writer is saying right there.
Amen.
He says, and seek my face and pray and turn from their wicked ways. And then, not before that, he says, then I will hear from heaven, I will forgive or pardon their sin, and I will heal the land.
Amen.
Church, if there was ever a time that we needed to pray for our nation, now is the time.
Yes.
The LGBT movement is pushing really hard, trying to get into the church. There's churches that are being threatened for not marrying LGBT people, for trying to follow the Lord, and they're getting more and more and more powerful.
Yes.
And church, we need to pray. Yes. The prayer is the greatest vehicle that we have besides the Word of God.
Amen.
It's the best vehicle, the most powerful vehicle that we have. We need to pray for those children along the border. We need to pray for this administration.
Yes.
We need to pray for that man over in North Korea.
Yes.
Church, we need to pray.
Amen.
And we need to pray for this, even this election coming up right now. We need to ask God, who do you want in this office?
Amen.
Church, we need to remain steadfast. And we need to pray. God is promising in verse 14 that God will restore us, that God will use us, and God will protect us if we would just humble ourselves and turn back to God.
Yes.
That's what he's saying right now. Humble ourselves and turn back to God. And then he says in verse 15 and 16, he says, now mine eyes, God is saying this, shall be open. In other words, God is saying that we will have his attention. He says, mine eyes shall be open and my ears attent unto the prayer. In other words, we will get an answer that is made in this place. He says, for now I have chosen and sanctify this house that my name may be there forever, and my eyes and my heart shall be there perpetually. Church, how many people here want this church this temple to be used mightily.
Yes.
How many people want to see this church move mightily? Amen. How many people want to see this church move in this neighborhood?
Amen.
In this neighborhood. I remember a few years ago, we went door to door, and a lot of people pretended not to speak English. But you see people coming to the church now, people from the community, and the reason why is because of the power of prayer.
Yes.
Prayer was breaking the culture barriers. Prayer was breaking the language barrier, but there's still a lot of work for us to do collectively, and God wants to use us also individually.
Yes.
But what He wants us to do is He wants us to dedicate our temples unto the Lord. You don't have to raise your hands right now, but is there something that you are doing in your life right now that is unfruitful, that is unproductive, that's unpleasing to Him? Is there something that you are doing right now that you know doesn't bring glory and honor to God, but it's a bad habit? If that's you, you need to repent. You need to drop that stuff aside, whatever it is. You need to drop that stuff aside, whatever it is. And you need to come back to your first love.
Yeah.
And you need to do whatever is necessary to get back into the right relationship with God. Some of us here may need to forgive some folks. Some of us here may need to learn how to resolve some conflicts. Some of us here may need to just have a better prayer life. Some of us here may need to spend some more time in the Word. Some of us here may need to do a combination of all of those things. Church, have you dedicated your temple unto God? Are you being used by God? And if you're not being used, you need to reevaluate your life.
Right now.
Do you want to just be on the same level spiritually? Year in and year out? Or do you want to be used like the people of God who are in this text? Do you want to be noticed by God like the people of God who are in this text? That's something that you have to answer for yourselves. Have you dedicated your temple to the Lord? Father God, we come to you right now. We come to you in the blessed name of Jesus. Father God, we thank you for this particular passage of Scripture. I personally thank you for the faith that Solomon and the people of God revealed at that particular time. And Father God, your word says that you are the same God yesterday, today, and tomorrow, and forever. You are the same God that can do the same miracles today that you were doing back then. Lord, I just ask in the name of Jesus, help us to clear our minds. And help us to not just know your word, but to believe your word. Father God, a lot of us know that we're supposed to be a holy people. But we believe that if we're holy, that we won't be effective, or that people will look down on us, or people won't accept us, or we're going to miss out on something, and we start cutting corners. But Father God, I just ask in the name of Jesus, help us to just believe and act on the word that you have given us. Help us as men be men of God. Help us as men, Father God, want to be the leaders. Help us as men to set the example as to what a good man really is. Help us to be holy men, whether we're married or single, in the blessed name of Jesus. Father God, I just ask in the name of Jesus, even the women, that they don't see us as the men that we used to be. Help them to see us the men that we could be. Help us to be the men of valor that we could be. Father God, we just thank you. And we just praise you. In Jesus' name, amen.